Our next talk will be about dynamic MRI reconstruction with motion-guided network from Professor Dimitris Metaxas' group.
Okay, so the previous talk was a nice introduction to what I'm going to say. So we've been working with various groups, especially Dr. Axel from NYU, towards this direction so that in the future everything will be done on the scanner, including segmentation. I'm going to show this probably in the next conference. But I'm going to show you here how you can use neural nets, combination of neural nets, to not just memorize K-space into real space, but how can you use sophisticated optimization methods, the way MRI is reconstructed now, and approximated with neural nets, and you can get much better results. So let me start with introduction. So static MRI was the talk before. Typically, it's done. You have an undersampled case space these days. There are many algorithms to do that, and either use neural nets or sparse methods. Back in 2010, we got the best paper award for using sparse methods. That was the hope at the time. But as you know, there are convex and methods, nonlinear, and you use methods like FISTA, and I'll show you the problems afterwards. And you can estimate, of course, the reconstructed image. And if you have dynamic MRI, then you use lots of images over time and use similar methods to do reconstruction. So dynamic MRI, of course, is very critical in clinical applications, such as cardiovascular and pulmonary. And exploring the motion information can further improve performance of dynamic reconstruction, since there is a correlation and redundancy exists along the temporal, of course, dimension. And for example, shape and motion of the heart doesn't change so much in successive frames, so like you see in this case. How about previous work? So traditionally, compressing sensing started the revolution of doing this. Many reconstruct approaches have successfully incorporated physical motion into the dynamic MRI reconstruction, lots of methods. And the limitation is there's a lot of heuristic parameter tuning, long reconstruction times, it was mentioned before, and inaccurate results if object temporal sampling is large or motion is irregular due to pathologies. So that's the reason why sparsity, even though there was a lot of hope, didn't produce the results we wanted. On the contrary, deep convolutional networks was proposed to learn the mapping directly from K-space so far, to fully sampled reconstruct images, several methods. The limitations, of course, that all these existing state-of-the-art methods don't take into account the motion information. The heart moves, if you're interested in the heart or the lungs, into consideration, may generate blurry or temporally inconsistent results. So I'm going to show you today the first motion-guided dynamic reconstruction network that utilizes motion estimation and motion compensation to improve reconstruction quality using spatiotemporal imaging constraints. So in a nutshell, what are we doing, right? So we have a three-step approach. First, you introduce a novel recurrent neural network, which links the relationship of the data over time to initially reconstruct an MRI sequence. Then we introduce an unsupervised interframe motion estimation network, which uses as input the result of the previous network. And then we combine the DRN and the ME, these two networks, through a new neural network to further refine the reconstruction results. So this three-step process you can see on the right. So this is the first time to do that, and let's see how is that done. So as I said, I'm going to follow the traditional sparse or other reconstruction methods, the optimization framework, so that, and I'm going to approximate this with neural net to produce better results. So as is done traditionally, you want to minimize this function, where T is the number of frames, 25, let's say, in a sequence. YT is the undersampled K-space data. ZT is the predicted reconstructed image. F is an operator that transforms image into Fourier domain followed by undersampling. And R is a regularization function that depends on the prior knowledge of the input. So you are trying the typical, you know, optimization approach. In step two, that's the first network. The second network basically tries to minimize the optical flow, the movement between frames. and to make a consistent motion where, you know, the gradient of ZT, basically the derivative of the image at position XY, and VT is the estimated displacement motion fields or optical flow. And the step three, which is the network that combines the previous, I'm trying to minimize the loss functions, the sum of these two loss functions, which is not really in traditional CS Bethlehem, are usually basically computationally expensive because they require a long running time for hyperparameter tuning. What to alleviate this problem, we introduce this new network to do motion guided reconstruction method. So let's see how this is done. Okay. So the step as follows, the first basically reconstruction is learns to reconstruct T frames in N iterations, and what is the undersampled K space data. Okay. So this is the undersampled K space data. ZT are the zero filling images, and ZT are the reconstructed images. Okay, over here. And the backbone is a UNet. This works the best. And DC layer ensures the data consistency. So in BNS are two kinds of congruent units. In machine learning, this is better than LSTM. Basically takes the time information integrates between successive frames. So these two are key, these two parts here. So, and then to be more detailed here, what we use is basically shows you the details of the BNS. So you have a repetition over space and time of to some iterations, basically to improve the network. Usually in this case, three iterations. Then the step to the next network has to do with the time, like between successive frames, right? You'd use two frames, successive frames, and you use a flow net to compute the optical flow, basically minimize and optimize, if you want, the distance between them. And you use this new optimization function here, which basically has to do with the image reconstruction loss. You suppress the unreal large magnitude of displacements. You want as little displacement as possible, and you won't make the displacement locally smooth, as is typically done basically in reconstruction methods with other optimization methods. So the UNet basically is the backbone, and basically by doing this, we're trying to find optical flow that makes sense between the two images. And the loss basically only enforces consistency between consecutive frames, but there's no guarantee for long-term coherence. So we modify this to a network of this type so that all the frames have to be consistent, not just two successive. It has to be long-term. So if there's an error, for example, between two successive frames, you want this to propagate. So you want to do a global optimization that takes into account all the frames while looking at successive frames. So basically, by doing that, then you obviously have much better results. And finally, you combine these two previous networks. This is the output of the DRN here. So from that output, you're trying now, given an image at time t, to basically compute the final result, while taking into account previous frames. And they don't have to be the one before and the one after. It could be up to 10 frames before and after. And it's done on purpose, so you have, as I said, a consistent motion throughout. And unfortunately, it could not be done with previous methods. Like sparsity and other methods, you couldn't do it. So only with networks we can play and have this global optimization approach. So basically, the MC network uses the previous to refine the reconstructed image from the DRN through motion information learned by the ME network to generate a new motion compensated image. And we had two additionally fully sampled reference frames, ZI before ZT and ZJ before ZT to further improve the motion estimation. And the output, of course, is this motion guided image. So let's show you some experiments. Again, like all networks, it takes time, could be, takes 2-3 days to train, but during execution is milliseconds. So there's no reason why it couldn't be done on a scanner. Okay, and that, as I said, I'm not showing here, the next step is we do reconstruction. And, you know, so far all of medicine has, especially in cardiac, and, has been done on slices. Well, the organs are volumetric. Why couldn't we estimate eventually a volumetric organ and then slice it the way we want, given the pathology? So I think there's going to be a revolution happening, not because of this method, but there's a lot of other, I'm sure, people working in this area. So neural nets will enable a huge transformation, I think, the way clinical practice is going to happen. So in the experiments, we have a short axis cardiac data set with 15 patients. This is a collaboration with NYU, but also Cornell. And the temporal resolution is 24 frames in 2D images that form a whole cardiac cycle. Spatial resolution, 12 image planes. And we simulate the K-space from 2D images. Basically, we have the K-space. We mean doing the inverse Fourier. And the Cartesian with Cartesian undersampling methods. And there are many different other methods, like Leon is working on golden ratios and others. There's lots of other methods to do that. So two different sparse sampling rates, 5 times and 8 times. I'm showing you on purpose sparsity. We could use, of course, the full space, just to show you that we can get very good results. And we perform threefold cross-validation in the experiments. And in the previous network, as I said, the distance between the frames could be 10, like 10 previous frames and 10 after. And in the BNNS networks that I was talking about, we do 3 times iterations. So in the experiment, we do dynamic spatiotemporal reconstruction. We compare to previous methods. And I'm reporting about the results. So you can see, based on the normalized root square error and the peak signal to noise ratio and the structural similarity index, this method, of course, outperforms because it uses, as I said, the neural nets and the movement between frames compared to all previous methods. And this shows you some reconstructions. So you can see here how much clearer it is compared to the ground truth. And you can see the other methods based on published, of course, code. And the other thing is I wanted to test, okay, how good, like the first speakers talked about interpretability, which is a big area direction we follow here. Any doctor would like to know what the network is doing, right? So how about the optical flow, basically the distance of the velocity, basically, between successive frames? Would like to know. So it's impossible for us to get the ground truth, but you can compute the Dice score and the Hausdorff distance of the overlapped area between the target image and the warped image. And the reference is directly calculates metrics using segmentation of the target phase and the reference phase. And the Hue flow net A would try 2 different things, like with only neighboring frame loss, while the UNO-net B with a combined frame loss. So that's like in slide 13 that I presented. So, and you can see, of course, the flow B does much better. And this is the estimation. This is a prelude of what we can do. I can segment at the same time. So segmentation should not happen after you make the image. You should segment in the K-space. So this shows you, of course, I'm not explaining here how we do the segmentation, but it shows you the differences between the arrows basically denote the direction of large displacements, and the second row represents the warped image and the warped myocardium contour for image T is equal to 1 using flow 1 greater than T. So the red contour is the ground truth, and the green contour is the warped myocardium. So it's very close. So these are encouraging results, and we are pushing more this kind of direction. Finally, I'd like to show you the motion compensation results. So it shows you the error in different frames, and it shows you if you just use the only the first network versus the combined, so you get much clearer results over time. So we have, as I said, it's encouraging, and only the nonlinearities of the K-space can be captured with these networks. So that's what I'd like to end. And if you have any questions, thank you very much.
So questions? In the middle.
Hi. I was wondering, I'm a doctor. You perform MR of the heart to get left ventricular function, volumes, ejection fraction, maybe some measure of the synchrony. Do you have any data about the comparability of your ground truth, ejection fraction, for example, and what the neural network generates?
Sorry, I didn't hear.
Do you have any information about, for example, ejection fraction measurements of, or maybe some measure of cardiac asynchrony?
Not in this paper. I didn't do that. But yes, that's what we're doing all this for, desynchrony. And of course, I've done in other desynchrony studies, assuming you have the images, I've calculated the dynamic actual ejection fraction, how the ejection fraction changes over time, not just the static one they do. Yes, I have a lot of this, but it's not about desynchrony, this thing. I want to apply all this stuff now in clinical situations, desynchrony and other, yeah.
Thank you.
Any other questions from the audience?
Yes.
Well, in the meanwhile, I may ask one. So, hi, here, I'm here. The session chair here.
Oh, sorry.
I have a question for you. So, I see that there are three steps in the whole framework, and I'm wondering, is it possible to train the DR and MEM, MC, and end-to-end way?
If I do end-to-end, you mean?
Yes.
Yeah, I could. We could. I just explained it in three steps.
So it's actually trained in end-to-end way. So it's actually trained in end-to-end way.
Right? Yes.
I see. Thank you. Yeah. So any more questions from the audience? We have time for a couple of questions, actually.
I was wondering if there's any dependence on where the frame comes in the sequence and the error. So I might imagine that the first or last frame has slightly more error because it doesn't have neighboring context either side. Have you observed error as a function of order within that sequence?
Basically, how the error changes over time? Well, I had a little bit of the, but it does a little bit, but with this new network, I'll show you. The reason why we're suppressing the error is because we have this here. This one is what suppresses the error, because it gets the influence of all frames to you know, everything affects everything. If you do this only, then you have errors. It increases a lot. So that made the difference. Okay. Yeah.
Other questions? Well, if no, let's thank speaker again. Maybe you can discuss offline.
Okay, thank you.